Well, first of all, we really have to be very grateful for Tim Bell's appearance today, because he has had an operation very recently, and the scar is
a throat's been cut.
Yeah, but nonetheless, he's so loyal to us, so we're extremely grateful.
Well, he's had lots of operations the rest of the time, so.
But I suspect that Lord Bell carried out this operation in order for him to be eternally, what's the word, vocal about everything you want to ask. Now, come in. Can I just have a show of hands who's here for the first time? Yeah, good, please. You saw the list, please come back, just a parish notice. We've got some very good people. We've got another communications man tomorrow, so you can compare the old school and the young Turk in the form of Mr. Matthew Freud. Turk. He's not that young, but I mean, relative to us, perhaps it is. Now, Tim has had an incredible career, and today, like all the people who come to speak at China Exchange, I want to let them say whatever they want, and if they run out of breath, which is unlikely, for Lord Bell, but if he were to go on too long, I might just interrupt him and ask him some awkward questions, and you can, but they've got to be intelligent.
There's a rather strange black pill here.
That is not to be swallowed. Anyway, Tim, do you want to say anything first? Before I start asking you a question, I mean, you can talk about anything you want. You can talk about your childhood, you can talk about your rise to fame, your accumulation of wealth. I said to Lord Bell that today he ought to imagine himself in his own office, and every question you ask, you're paying him £10,000. Okay? Because that's the way he works.
He said £50,000. It's gone down.
You were labelled by Mrs. Thatcher as the man on the Clapham omnibus. And those of us who know about the Clapham omnibus, made famous by Lord Denning, I think, in a very famous case, and depicts the ordinary person. Do you think that was a good description, or do you think it was slightly wrong?
I think it was her way of defining a role for me, which was probably said more about her than me. I don't think she knew what the Clapham omnibus was.
You think he used you as an excuse to
it was a polite way of saying I was very ordinary.
No, I think that she might have thought that she was surrounded by all these experts, but he wanted to hear the common voice.
That's
coming from you.
She didn't think that she was in touch with ordinary people. And indeed the public in the air when they threw her out, didn't think she was in touch with them either. But she went through a period of time when she reflected the way people felt about life and sort of things that mattered to them, that worked well and didn't work well. It's a phrase you hear journalists saying all the time, the politicians are out of touch with ordinary people. I don't think they ever thought that about her until she put the poll tax on. She destroyed her own career by inventing the poll tax, because she did something which we had built her up to stand for low taxation. And suddenly, she issued a tax bill to perfectly ordinary people, which was for thousands and thousands of pounds.
What was the one thing that you think drove her to being so asinine about the poll tax?
Nicholas Ridley was asked to cost it, and he never pointed out that the Duke of Westminster would pay the same amount in poll tax as the dustman. And the other side grabbed hold of that and talked about the Duke and the dustman, and they were very effective, and they made people absolutely horrified by the poll tax. The main problem with the poll tax was so huge. Perfectly ordinary people who'd never seen a bill for £14,000 suddenly got a bill for £14,000 they didn't know what for.
I mean, I'm amazed that she thought she was out of touch, because she wasn't, as if she was born out of an aristocracy. I mean, she was a Grantham grammar school girl and so forth. So why did she think she might have been out of touch with the common people?
Well, I think because She recognised that she'd also been to Somerville. She'd studied, she was a graduate. She had a degree, she'd studied politics, she'd studied science, she was a qualified barrister, a chemist, a biologist. And she felt very well educated and realised that most people weren't as well educated as her. And that therefore she had a very important job, which is where I come into, which was to explain to ordinary people, in ordinary people's language, what she was talking about. So
did
for example,
you first approach her and say, now I got to tell you how to explain all this to the ordinary people.
No.
So how did you get her to trust you in the first place? Tell us the story.
Well,
it's been a seminal moment when you stood in for a diseased pianist at a concerto and suddenly became famous. I mean, what happened?
She had a communications guru called Sir Gordon Rees. He's a short man, looked like Ronnie Corbett.
From South Africa?
No, he's from England. He was a Roman Catholic who had 8 children. Then he got divorced and was excommunicated, which broke his heart. His wife posed as a lollipop lady in Brighton for the local papers in order to make it look as though he was a mean sod who didn't care for his children. So he got divorced. He used to produce the Sunday night at the London Palladium, I'm sure, for those of you who are. Actually, nobody in this audience is old enough to remember it, but it used to be called Sunday Night at the London Palladium. It featured famous stars. They went to the Palladium, did an act, and everybody laughed with jugglers and acrobats and so on. It's on television, it's still now, but none of you would watch it. And he used to do a special night at Royal Variety Show, which the Queen went to. And he produced that, and then after he'd done that very successfully, he then got given the God slot. So he did the Songs of Praise on a Sunday evening. He fell in love with the girl who produced it and had a rather unfortunate affair with her, which caused some difficulty in the religious department of the BBC. So he lost that job as well. So he became Mrs. Thatcher's publicity advisor, which is an obvious thing to do. And he actually introduced us to her because he said he'd been travelling around America, watched the Republican primary, watched the stupid things they have that they're about to do with Donald Trump. And he thought that television was a very important thing. And the next election, this is back in 1979, if any of you can remember that far back.
Was that the first time that you got involved?
Yeah. I had been involved with Ted Heath in earlier incarnations, but that was very boring because Ted Heath was so dull, it was impossible to do.
Did you help him win? He won
by accident because the people had got fed up with Harold Wilson, had got fed up with Labour. They were
Michael Foot.
No, Michael Foot was 1983, that was a different period. Do try and get your history right.
That's a warning.
Absolutely. The first election was 1979.
I mean, both Harry Wilson.
Shall I be a straight man and you didn't mind?
Carry on. So this man, Gordon Rees, who was had an affair, was an adulterer, somehow became Mrs. Thatcher.
He was a confessional Catholic, so he would go and apologise for his adultery.
So he actually brought you in to see Mrs. Thatcher.
He got up one day and he said, we need an advertising agency because this is going to be about television. The people who are experts on television advertising agencies. And then he asked a friend of his who worked in the advertising business, what's the most trendy, fashionable advertising agency? And they said, Such and Such. He gasped for a moment, wondering what the hell that was. Lord Stokes once accused us of being a Chinese laundry, which is the only Chinese joke I've heard all of you. And he sent her around to see us, and she rang up Horace Sarchi. One day, actually Lord Thornycroft, who was the chairman of the party, rang up Maurice Sarchi. Maurice Sarchi didn't want to speak to him because he thought he might be so posh that he would make a fool of himself. So he transferred the call to me because I used to live in Norfolk. Norfolk is where rich people live. And I hadn't been to Eton or anything like that, not today. In fact, I think they'd been to something Catholic grammar, which was very odd for two Jewish brothers, but they went to that. So I spoke to him and he said, would you like to do the Tory Party's advertising campaign? And I said, no. And he said, why not? And I said, because there's no money in it, it's all consuming and you're never happy with anything. And he said, well, could you speak to the brothers and tell me what they think? So I spoke to the brothers and they said, well, you can do it. I said, I don't want to do it, so you have to. So all right. So I thought we'd sort it out. So we do it. And that's what we were appointed. And I was sent round to see her.
For the first time?
Yes.
She was this the first time you met her?
First time I met her. I'd actually seen her because I lived in Barnet. And the MP in Barnet was Reggie Baldwin. She was the MP for Finchley. And so I'd actually worked in the grassroots of the Tory party, because we'd all joined the Young Conservatives.
It was Home Secretary, so I got that
red warning.
Yes. Yes.
We all joined the Young Conservatives. The agent, his name was Fawcett, had a very pretty daughter called Trudy. And everybody wanted to screw Trudy, so in order to do that, they had to join the Young Conservatives. So we all joined the Young Conservatives. And we,
you screw up.
No. Most of us didn't. Most of us talked about it, but didn't do it. So I discovered that's a great.
Who screwed up?
It's a great lesson to learn in life, is that people talk a lot about
that. And who screwed up?
I don't know. Mr. Fawcett, I think.
That's really. But okay, so anyway, where did you meet her?
I met her in the opposition leader's room in St. Stephen's in the House of Commons. It was a big room. It had a brown sofa, brown velvet sofa, brown velvet armchair, flowers, because she liked flowers. And outside there was an outer office with two girls who were Sloan Ranger typists who typed at 100 miles an hour. One was called Alison, one was called Caroline. And we arrived, in those days you could drive into the House of Commons, there weren't police or anything, you just drive in and drive around St. Stephen's entrance. And a policeman stood there and he said, hello, the policeman stood and he went, he's the leader of the opposition, and he went into this sort of turret and went around everywhere until he got to it. Actually, the first time we drove, my driver, his name was John, who had love and hate tattooed on his fingers. He was a sergeant. And he stopped outside the entrance and met the dog collar walked out and said, don't park there. And he said, don't you fucking tell me where I can park. The bloody finger tells my club he's going to see the leader of the opposition. And it was in Paisley. I've never been so frightened in my life because I was convinced he would go like that and a bolt of lightning would strike me. Anyway, I went in to see her. And on the way there, I bumped into Harry Neave, who was her chief of staff. Harry Neave was murdered when they blew him up in the car park at Westminster years ago. He was a lovely man. He escaped from Colditz. He was a really fabulous Irishman. And he was standing in the corridor outside the secretary's office with a raincoat buttoned up to his neck, looking like a sort of third hand journalist or spy. And he said, are you going to see her? And I said, yes. He said, be gentle. I didn't know what that meant, so I said, right. Opened the door of the secretary's office, they were both typing computers, and looked up at me and said, yes. And I said, I'm from such and such. She pressed the intercom and said, Mrs. Thatcher, the man from Starsky and Hutch is here. So I sort of went very lame, and Gordon appeared from a shadow.
Not that it would have made any difference to her.
Gordon appeared from a shadow and took me into a room, and I sat in the middle of the sofa, this long brown velvet sofa, which I'd always been taught not to do that, because you've got nowhere, you just hang in the middle, you've got nowhere to lean on or hide, just sit there, feeling exposed. And she sat in the corner on her armchair, at her desk, and she said, what's your favourite poem? And I said, If. Who told you? I said, what? Who told you? Never told me anything. She said, it's my favorite. I opened her handbag and dragged out a bruised copy of If. And said, If is the most important poem ever written in English. If you want to know how to deal with a crisis, read If. If is a complete art of dealing with crises and problems all your life. If you can keep your head, you're all about losing theirs. If you can be lied about and not turn to lie. It's just brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant. It makes me cry every time I read it myself. It's got an end line, which is what, well, you'll be a man, my son, and all reminds me of my father.
Never lose the common touch.
No. And then she said, have you been born with cabbages and kings? Something like
cabbages.
And then she said, what's your favourite speech? Now, at the time, I thought that it was a speech by Abraham Lincoln. It turns out later on it wasn't. But I said, Lincoln, she said, what? I said, I fail to see how making the rich poor will make the poor rich. I fail to see how making the strong weak will make the weak strong. She sat for a moment. She said, who told you? I said, who told you? She said, somebody's briefed you. I said, Gordon? Did you? She said, no, I didn't. I'm a different leader. And she opened a bag and took out a battered copy of Abraham Lincoln's speech. So I thought, my God, this is going well, let me get out of here. Can I go now? And she said, right, well, you always know what you're doing. I said, thank you very much. You call the opposition leader. You don't call her anything, tell them her name's called leader. And so I said, thank you, leader. And she said, now, politicians have very long fingers and very long toes, and you can tread on them very easily by carelessness. I don't have any fingers or toes, and you will always tell me the truth. So I said, yes, leader. She said, right, you can go now. So I thought, fantastic. And I said, have we got the job? Don't be ridiculous, ask Lord Thornycroft. So I went.
So that was how you started at the
election.
Your daughter.
Yes,
at the.
She looked like my mother.
Yeah.
I always used to call her mother because she looked like my mother. She was like my mother. My mother was always telling me off. She was the, my mother used to walk in the room and say, get a haircut. It's the first thing Margaret ever said to me, get a haircut.
But that was the election with which you really became famous for that famous line, Labour isn't working. Corinna, how did that come about?
Labour isn't working.
What did she think when you first told it to her?
Labour isn't working was written by a man called Andrew Rutherford, a copywriter, and art directed by a man called Ron Lather, who left Sargent and went to Australia and ran an agency called Campaign Palace. And it wasn't written by me, I wasn't a creative, I was a suit. So I took the poster, which had been rendered by the art department, which was run by a man called Melvin Redford. And it was typeset in a typeface that was used by Colt Dickinson and Pierce by everybody. And it was art directed, it consisted of this line saying Labour isn't working. And there was a little poster sign which said Dole. And there was a queue of people who actually were young conservatives from Enfield. In those days, technology didn't enable you to repeat things, so it repeated the people. If you look at it closely, you'll find the first 50 people are repeated and repeated and repeated. Nowadays, they can multiply it by technology, but it didn't. And I took Sherita. And she said, yes. I said, this is the poster. It has got another man's name in the title. He said, Labour, got Labour in it. People don't read anything else, they just read the word. I said, no, it's a double entendre. And she said, double entendre? I hope the public's smart enough to get the double entendre. And I said, she said, what is the double entendre? I said, well, it's Labour isn't working, the Labour government's not working, and there's high unemployment. Unemployment will get worse when I come to power. I didn't tell them that. Oh, I won't tell them. And so she eventually approved it. One or two people didn't like it very much. A lot of people said, it's hostage of fortune. If you don't know what hostage of fortune is, it's the most frequently used phrase in politics other than the law of unintended consequences. Hostage of fortune means when you say something that later on turns out not to be true. Now, in the old days, when I first worked in the business, 40, 50 years ago, politicians were petrified of hostages of fortune, and they wouldn't say anything, and they were very careful what they said. Nowadays, they're much more careless, and people would give hostages of fortune all the time. I mean, Karen's probably done more hostages of fortune in the 2 or 3 years he's been the leader than anyone's ever done. Jeremy Corbyn's whole life is a hostage of fortune. So, and Nick Clegg, well, can't talk about Nick Clegg. Sorry, if there are any Liberal Democrats present, I apologise, I hate you. I particularly hate Nick Clegg and Tim Farron.
But you Tim fast, so you fast forward to today's administration. I mean, in your book,
which I right or wrong,
right or wrong,
by
obviously right, but I felt that you were slightly nostalgic. There it is. You just gave us a marvelous recollection of how you met this great woman, turned out to be the most extraordinary woman of last century, and how you triumphed with a single line which everybody remembered. Now today, if you were still in the middle of politics and you were advising, Prime Minister or whoever, Would the idea of a one-liner be an essential way of communication, given that communication is now very different?
If I were running the Leave campaign in the EU referendum, I would run a poster which had a big headline that said the European Union isn't working. There would be a huge crew of cured migrants if it would say EU border, and that would swing the vote by 10%.
And why doesn't Alistair Campbell
say? And the next ad would say, would mention the Eurozone, the failure of the Greek banking crisis, and so on and so forth. And it would just, I would simply say that the European Union doesn't work. Everybody knows it doesn't work. Everybody says it needs to be reformed. Why does it need to be reformed? Because it doesn't work. So they're all going to go and reform it. So they can't.
But do you think,
as we go, sir,
do you think Brexit could possibly win?
Yes.
You think so?
I think it could.
And if that happens, we had Norman Lamont here the other day, who surprised me by saying that if Brexit did win, the Prime Minister, David Cameron, might not have to resign. Indeed, he should resign.
Norman Lamont is the man who put, interestingly, about 15% on the day of the ERM's debacle. I mean, he's a lovely man, Norman, but his predictions are not very good.
So let's break ourselves to a Brexit. I mean, I
don't know. Look, I don't know. I mean, the polls say it's neck and neck. Now, the problem with the polls is that he who lives by the polls dies by the polls. So you have to use your own judgment. And I would say that he's 50-50. Both sides are in very bad campaigns. It's quite right that negative advertising is more effective than any other form of advertising, because people vote against what they fear rather than for what they desire. Because they're all basically pessimists. If you think you're at home and you decide, what should we watch on television? Let's see what's on, you say. Don't want to watch that, don't want to watch that, don't want to watch that. There must be something I want to watch. And that's the choice that people are faced with. When you go to the cinema, I say, what should we go and see? I don't want to see that. Somebody else saw that. I don't want to see that. So you end up going to the least painful one.
It doesn't happen in marriage.
No.
When you go for the positive. No.
Marriage is rather different. There's my fiance sitting on it. marriage is rather different. Marriage is a very optimistic experience, which can end in disaster, but not always. I don't think you can draw the parallel. I want to stick to Europe. I'm much more comfortable.
Okay, well, I'm going to ask people to ask you questions in 2 minutes, but I always be curious. You were knighted by Mrs. Thatcher, but you were ennobled by Blair. How did that come about? Why didn't Mrs. Thatcher make
William Hague? John Major gave a peerage to Geoffrey Archer, Maurice Sarchi, and Peter Tatlin. He didn't give me one, he didn't like me. I already had a knighthood from her. So when Brian Mar, when he, who was none of you remember, who was the chairman of the party, when he left office, he left a note for the next chairman which said, we owed him the peerage. And the next chairman to the party got this note, in fact, the next leader got it, which was William Hague. William Hague said to Seb Coe, who really need to make a peer, and he said, Tim Bell. Then one day Seb rang me up and said, would you be a peer? And I said, yeah. And then the system is such that the leader of your party doesn't write you. The Prime Minister writes to you and says, Her Majesty the Queen is considering ennobling you. Then you have to say yes or no, because if you say no, she doesn't do it, because that would be embarrassing. Otherwise, have lots of people say, I turned it down. You can't turn the Queen down. So I said yes. Actually, funny enough, Downing Street rang me up. This is very funny, actually. A secretary at Downing Street rang up and said, the Prime Minister would like to speak to you. And I said, no. The switchboard in Downing Street is called Switch. Everybody calls it Switch. Hello, Switch. They know who everybody is and they know everybody's numbers. When you want somebody, I don't know if it's like that now, in those days it was. If you want somebody, you pick up the phone, you say, get me Nick Ridley, put the phone down. And Switch gets you Nick Ridley. And so this is obviously after me, and they got me. In fact, funnily enough, if you go into Downing Street now and you ask to speak to me, they'll immediately dial my number. Even though I haven't been there for years, they know who I am. But they've got me on the list. And she said, the Prime Minister wants to speak to her. I said, no, I didn't. It's good news. I said, pardon? It's good news. I said, why are you whispering? She said, it's secret. I said, oh, what's the secret? She told me that. So when I got put through to the Prime Minister, who was sitting there, she said, I want to see you at 4:00.
Can I prepare myself for it? She didn't.
No. So I went round to four, and there was a long list of people. This was her resignation honours list. All prime ministers have a resignation honours list. And there was a list of people, including my name, and what they were going to get. She said, I want to have a look at this list and see if you think that will go down. So I saw all my friends' names out of it, and I thought, I could just cross them off. You know, could they meet him? I must be a nice person. So
she is a very nice person. She is very good.
And then she did.
But why didn't she give you a peerage? Then?
She didn't give people peerages in those days. The currency has changed completely in the old days.
Gave Whitehall, not only the peerage, but their
relatives. Why was the deputy prime minister? I was a bloody cops man. I was the deputy prime minister. And he got given an hereditary title because he had no children.
Yeah, but my question was, how come Blair, there was
a peerage? Because the system is that Blair, the prime minister of the day, writes the letter offering you a peerage.
Did he ring you up?
No.
Did he tell you it was good news or bad news?
No, he didn't tell you, he sent me a letter.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, Semco had already rung me up and said it was going to happen.
Did you interact with Blair when he came to power?
I saw Blair when Cherie decided to write a book on the spouses at Downing Street, which he wanted to know about Dennis Thatcher. And she asked me to go around for tea. No sandwich, like sandwich lunch. And I went out to Downing Street and arrived. I saw the policeman. It was the same policeman who was there on my day. I said, hello, he said, hello. And the door opened and the butler opened. He said, hello, Tim.
Hello.
He said, how are you? I said, fine. He said, do you want to come here? So they are all here. They're not nice here anymore. I said, no. He said, give me a phone. I said, we should take your phone, you've got no phone here, blow people up, you know. So I took my phone and stuck it in a pigeon. And he said, don't go out to the flat, they don't live there, they live in number 11. So go through this door. So I went through this door into a very large room. It's a completely true story, none of you will believe it, but it's completely true. A very large room full of toys, nothing but toys, including a small guitar, a stool, and a little microphone, a child's microphone, which is clearly where Blair practiced to sing. And I sat there, like 11, and then a secretary came out and said, Mrs. Blair won't be long, she's just finishing her last interview, would you mind sitting there? Then all of a sudden, round the corner came Tony Blair. He said, hello. I said, hello. How are you? He said, I'm very well, I've recovered from this mild heart attack which I had. There's nothing important, I'm completely fit, here's my doctor's certificate. Then it was like a fair press release. I said, don't worry, it's only a coup. He said, what? I said, we're going to get a coup and get rid of you. He said, really? Is that why you're here? I said, no. It's not why I'm here, it's a joke. I said, sense of humor. And he said, no, I haven't got a sense of humor, but that sort of thing is concerned. And he said, what are you here for? I said, I'm here to see your wife. You've got no taste, he said. I said, no taste at all. So I'm saying, on top. I'd seen him once before at Rupert Murdoch's cocktail party when he said to me, do you think I'm peaking too soon? I said, yes. But don't worry about it, you'll get away with it. Cherie came in and said, come to Cutler and have a sandwich. They've gone and sent somebody round to Millbank to buy two plastic sandwiches in a plastic bag. One was an egg mayonnaise and the other one was something else, lettuce and something. And she said, you can have a sandwich. And I said, thank you very much. I think I'll totally eat this. And then she said, now tell me about, what's so terrible, she said, is there's no difference. I said, what do you mean there's no difference? Nobody's replied. I said, You bloody well abolish difference. You're the marriage of the bloke, he said, call me Tone. There's no difference. And I said, yeah, well, there's no difference. He said, what was Dennis like? I said, Dennis was fantastically funny. She said, why was he so funny? I said, because he used to tell the truth. He would say to somebody, excuse me, are you doing all right? He said, yes. Do you go to Eton or are you in the Guards? No, no. Well, how could you possibly succeed if you weren't at Eton or weren't in the Guards? And then he'd go out and the security boys would say, the other side detective, he'd say, no, it just attracts bombs. We don't need to say, I'm going out on my own. And they'd follow in the distance behind me. He once walked into a pub with me in Berkeley Square, running footman. And then he said, you get the first round, so I bought him a pint and a scotch. And he said, I'll get the next round. He went out to the bar, he said, a pint and a scotch. They both stand in the bar and said, yeah, aren't you that Dennis Thatcher? He said, no, I'm bloody well not. I know I look like him, and people are always mistaken. I'm not him, but leave me alone. But I said, sorry, come. Okay, what's that now?
But did Cherry Blair write that book?
She did. It was a load of crap.
Well, she's happy to speak, but we'll ask her. Tim Bell thought that your book on the spouse and have a turn of leather crap. You agree. Listen, half an hour has gone, so I want to stop you and let you ask questions. So who might have an interesting or intelligent question to ask Lord Bell? Okay.
So you said earlier you were...
Just use the microphone, 2 minutes.
Hi, so you said earlier you were super non-creative, so how did you end up in the PR industry?
By accident. Because the agency I was then the chairman of, which was called Low House Wink and Bell, which had previously been known as Low House Wink, which I joined when I left such and such in 1984, bought a public relations company called Good Relations. And then one day, Frank Lowe and I fell out with each other. As he described, we used to chase the same ball, and we'd fall over trying to catch it. And he said, I think you'd better go. And I said, well, I don't want to go. He said, well, you have to. Why don't you go and take all the other the companies that aren't advertising agencies and start a new company called Lowe Bell? So I said, right. So I went and did a management buyout. It cost me about £4 million. I mean, he was a very good negotiator, Frank. He gave me all this crap and made me pay for it. and so that's why I got into public, bought a company called Good Relations, which I thought was a very good name for a public relations company, except that the man who had launched and started it, called Tony Good, had a terrible stammer. So he used to say, hello, I'm Tony Good. You know how people finish people with stammer? They say, good? You'd say, no, you know, good. There's an old joke about circumcision, which I won't tell. And so I hadn't run a public relations company. But there's no difference between public relations and advertising. I know everybody likes to think there is. Advertising is the use of paid for space to inform and persuade, and public relations is the use of third party endorsement to inform and persuade. So they have the same objective, same purpose. One's more expensive, make more money out of it. He said, I was rich, I'm not rich, I'm very poor. I would have been rich if I stayed in advertising. There are others. Some one man here who is in advertising is very rich.
Why did you leave such and such?
When I leave such and such, because I'd taken too much cocaine and I was off my head.
Okay, well, there it is. Yes.
Hello. Just most of people in the American political season, I was just wondering, from a PR perspective, what do you make of Donald Trump's successful nomination campaign? And do you think something similar could succeed in the UK?
I'm not a great student of American politics. I don't understand the system, which I think is very strange. It's got nothing to do with democracy whatsoever. I don't understand the it was invented by John Kennedy when he did the sweep around America. And ever since then, every politician has had to sweep all around America and go to every state. Every state thinks they're terribly important. I think that it's probably a reflection of the pygmy-like status of the leaders of the Republican Party and the leaders of the Democrat Party, and a great deal of satisfaction with that appalling man at Barack Obama, which is not a popular view, but it's my view. would like him one day to tell him anything he ever did. Didn't even manage to close the Guantanamo Bay, let alone anything else.
He got through the health bill.
No, he didn't.
Yes, he did. I mean, eventually.
Yeah, it's the thing that has destroyed us.
I know, it didn't work, but he did push through the bill.
But if you think it's a good thing to introduce health service, then you're in a different world to me. So it's destroyed our national world.
We were talking yesterday with Jeremy Carson that the National Health is the third largest public employer in the world after the American Defense and People's Liberation Army.
Yeah, it used to be GEC.
Yeah. Ronnie Grizz. Sorry, yes.
No, I was just going to ask, which was the most challenging, or if you like, or the most interesting campaign you ever worked on? And why was that?
The next one. I'm sorry, I haven't been choking yet. the most challenging campaign was probably the anti-apartheid, post-apartheid election in South Africa, when I represented F.W. de Klerk and the white people in the Nationalist Party, against the ANC, who had a 78% share of the vote, and we had to get 25% share of the vote in order to qualify for two places in the cabinet and to keep a mixed government of national unity in power. We managed to get 27%. So I think that was probably the most difficult thing I've ever done. It was a very strange campaign because we all used to meet on a Friday night because we were petrified of starting a civil war. So all the advisors used to meet and tell each other what they were doing. So Stan Greenberg, who represented the ANC, used to meet with us and we represented the National Party, and we used to meet other people who represented Buttigieg, and we used to show each other the posters and the ads and the arguments, and it contained three things which I'm very proud of. One was it contained the only ever confrontation between two political leaders which was not fixed, which was completely pure. The audience could do what they liked. They were allowed to shout, yell, wave banners, anything. Just to split in half, ANC one half of the room, National Party the other. Thabo Mbeki, it was the deputy leader of the ANC, and Mbeki was the foreign secretary in the nationalist government. And they sat there, because it was in a post-apartheid era, so there had to be two chairmen, one black, one white, four journalists, two black, two white, one BBC black, one South African black, one American white, and one South African white. They all had to ask questions in different order. And after they'd gone through this unbelievably boring thing, which the audience tried to get excited and rattled and waved scarves, and so it got to the end. And the black chairman said, I think we ought to say thank you to the people at home and television who've been watching this. And so perhaps you'd like to say thank you. Perhaps I'll start with you, Mr. Botha. Pick Botha said, all those people at home watching this programme who are going to vote for the National Party, I say this. Drive home safely. To all those people who are not going to vote for the National Party, who am I to tell you how to drive? And the place collapsed in hysterics. Then Thabo Mbeki couldn't speak after that. He didn't know what to do. And it was a fabulously funny occasion. And it was very good. I remember going to a rally in Soweto. The first rally I went to was Nelson Mandela's rally. And I mean, it was hysterical. I never understood anything he ever said. And still, to this day, you could never understand what he said. You could have heard the telephone direction, they just screamed and ranted. And then F.W. de Klerk came along and said, they had exactly the same reaction, because he was a famous person. It was just a response to that. Unfortunately, they put a bomb in the piano that was on the stage, so we nearly got blown up and managed to avoid that. It was a fantastic.
But were you not helped by the fact that there was an air of the state of reconciliation, so that they might have felt it was necessary to embrace the white after all?
The Truth and Reconciliation Commission was after the election, not before.
I know, but nonetheless, that was what Mandela wanted to happen when the end of the apartheid came.
All three of the main political parties agreed they did not have a civil war.
Exactly.
And they all agreed that they'd better be careful about the result, and so the result was fixed. Right. So you can tell this to anybody, you know, Judge Goldstone, who was the man who oversaw the Electoral Commission, got a result that resulted in Pretoria, which is the capital of South Africa, went to the White Party. And so they changed the result.
So it was fixed?
Yeah.
They changed the result.
So how come it was challenged?
It was challenged by various people. People brought ballot boxes that were full of grass.
But did you realise it at the time?
It mattered because what mattered was that there was a fair result, and a fair result was a big thumping great win for the ANC, the establishment of a government of national unity, not an adversarial government, with white people in it, and brown people, and coloureds, and black people in it. And the whites had two cabinet positions, the finance minister, which was Tony,
and
the deputy president, which was de Klerk. The president was Mandela, the other ministers were various people. De Klerk pulled out of the coalition government after about 2 years, and he now travelled the world. He's probably the best speaker you've ever come across if you want to listen to somebody talk about racial prejudice and talk about how you deal with it. De Klerk is just an absolute genius, brilliant man. He got the Nobel Peace Prize and long deserved it, a lot more than Barack bloody Obama deserved it before he did anything. Mandela got the prize and so did Buttigieg.
If that question was in answer to your retort, the next one is the best, most challenging one, Who would you like to ring you up tomorrow and say, Tim, come and help me? I mean, is it
Boris
Philip Green or
Boris Johnson?
What?
Boris Johnson.
Boris Johnson. You think you can help him become Prime Minister?
Yes.
And how about Philip Green?
God no.
All right.
Everyone said the same rumors.
Lord Bell, I was just interested to know whether at any point in your career you thought that being too closely involved with politics would be, you know, could have a negative effect on your career or business.
Every day. Every single day. It made me very vulnerable. Because whoever I worked with always got cross because I expressed my political views. And I'm in a campaign magazine, which is the mouthpiece of the industry, wrote when I was put in the campaign fame, ludicrous, this phrase I got. A man wrote an article about me which began, an unreformed smoker, an unreconstructed Thatcherite, and a man who's so politically incorrect, he never hesitated to upset people as much as he possibly can. He meant it as an insult. I took it as the greatest compliment I've ever been paid. And I tell it all the time because I'm very proud of it. Actually, he told me years later that he meant it quite seriously. You need to think I was quite smart. I don't know why. But I've never been politically correct. I don't see the point in it. I don't see the point in lying.
But does that mean that you wouldn't mind? There is no morality in your advising or representing somebody. It's like a sort of barrister who might not want to represent somebody who's confessed a felon or whatever. I mean, do you pick and choose your clients very carefully?
Yes.
By their
not by morality.
By them.
None
money.
Of you morality. I'm just selfish. I don't believe in morality.
So if they paid you enough, you would.
I believe no. They do that. I believe in right and wrong. I think I know what the difference between right and wrong is, and I live off my own judgment. My moral code is about right and wrong, as everybody should be.
Do you think Pinochet was generally right?
I think Pinochet did lots of things that were right, lots of things that were wrong. I think the Labour government put him under house arrest, having invited him as a diplomat and then arrested him and stuck him in the house. It was absolutely wrong. I think that the Spanish magistrate who tried to get him extradited, who had previously tried and actually killed Allende, who was Pinochet's opponent at the time, whose fingerprints were on the gun that shot him, was a disgusting man, and I'm very proud of the campaign. I did it with Ned, with a famous lawyer, and we did it very well. He got sent back to Santiago, and he didn't go to Spain.
With a lot of help from Mrs. Thatcher as well.
No help from Mrs. Thatcher whatsoever.
Really?
No.
I thought she went.
No, because the Labour Party were in power. Jack Straw locked him up. He's a man to a man. The original straw men.
Man of straw.
If Angela Merkel was to call you up today, what would you tell her advice?
Nine.
No wise words whatsoever.
Nine. Fear is enough. It's good.
Do you think she's going to last?
I don't think the European Union will last. I don't know how long it'll take. Once the European Union goes, then Germany's power base goes.
Do you think letting in a million refugees, she might come to regret it?
I think she regrets it already. So, and look, she's from Eastern Germany.
Yes.
She's bound to be influenced by her background. And she is. I don't have a solution to the migration problem. But anybody else in this room? She certainly doesn't know the solution. Nobody else does. The European Union doesn't know the solution. It's another example of why the European Union doesn't work. We rescued Germany in 1946. The Americans and us rescued Germany and the whole of Europe from an appalling monster of a man called Adolf Hitler, much of my recollection, and an appalling man, an evil piece of garbage that was created by the devil. We rescued Europe and we just paid for it ever since, and now we're being asked to rescue them again. Whatever we do, we should vote no.
The Hitler is dead.
Why is that? Right. Well, he's actually. Maybe that the Greek finance.
Yeah, well, he was stupid.
Um,
So hi, you mentioned general picture before. Yeah. So what do you think the fundamental reasons for the opposition party in Chile to won for the, during the campaign, the no campaign? And if there's hypothetically there's a referendum coming to China, so how do you think if a campaign that's smart enough or brilliant enough for us to achieve democracy in that way?
Well, if you promise not to tell anybody, I'll tell you the answer. The referendum campaign in Chile, in case anybody doesn't understand, was a very simple referendum which said, do you want 5 more years of Pinochet or somebody else? And all somebody else won, 54-46. Campaign, I ran Pinochet's campaign, so I can't, we lost. The no campaign, as it was called, the yes no campaign, was a brilliant campaign, which had the best idea I've ever seen, which if we'd done in Scotland, we'd have won by 20 points. If we did now in the European referendum, we'd win by 30 points. Which was a very simple campaign, which said, happy people vote no. And he made television commercials of people getting married, people having babies, people getting engaged, people going to a party in Jones, and he just said, happy people vote no. And the no vote won by miles. It's a piece of genius. If you get the chance to nick it for China, do. You don't have to pay anybody. It was done by an advertising agent, a public affairs consultant called Sawyer Miller, which was run by a lovely man called David, sorry, sadly died of cancer years ago, and Scott Miller, who later became the marketing director of Coca-Cola. It's a piece of absolute genius. And it was also part of the debate, and there was an appalling man called Mark Mallett Brown, who's now a peer, and it was the deputy head of the United Nations, who obviously wasn't involved in the campaign, otherwise it would have been crap. But that was it was just the most brilliant campaign I've ever seen.
I was in Santiago on the day the plebiscite took place. I remember I saw lots of flags of Pinochet. Didn't realize that you were behind it, so it is.
Lots.
Another question. Yes.
Not that I didn't vote for myself, why are you so passionately against them?
Who?
The Lib Dems.
Oh, because they're rubbish people who sit in the middle. They wander around the middle of the road. Cars go past on all sides and they all go, yes, what we need now is a group in the middle of the road party. They lie about what they are. They're actually socialists, much worse than socialists, because their socialists don't admit they're socialists. Nick Clegg's the most appalling man who's ever lived. And that's what Tim Farron, I mean, really. Have you ever seen that bloke Owen Jones? They now whip out to he's a blogger, and they put him on to, he looks, sounds exactly like Tim Farron. I look at him, I want to kill him, because he sounds like Tim
Farron. I don't think they're going to kill anybody. I think they're going to die.
They won't lie down, you know. It's one of those terrible things, they just keep popping up, and they keep talking about the need for a jolly good middle ground, and I'm committed not believing in anything, thinking.
I guess there's a new book on Jeremy Thorpe coming out.
Jeremy Thorpe?
Yes.
Well, I remember Jeremy Thorpe. When Jeremy Thorpe was on trial, Margaret said to me, if Jeremy Thorpe is found innocent, I shall bring Jack Profumo back into the cabinet and make him himself. And if you know about the Profumo affair, you'll understand what she meant.
But she was remarkable. I'm sure you were there. On the 70th birthday, she sat Profumo between herself and the Queen. Very forgiving, very moving moment. Those of you who don't.
Jack obviously had an affair with Christine Keeler and Mandy Rice Davis, and was all wrapped up with her.
So and he did a lot of good things afterwards. Now, on her 70th birthday, Profumo sat between herself and the
Queen. She was known to a famous actress. They gave all their money to Sharon.
Amazing. That's great forgiveness. Yes.
Hi, I'd be interested to know what do you think is the biggest mistake you made in your career and what did you actually learn from it?
Not being paid enough money. Not knowing enough of what I did. The biggest mistake, I mean, I made so many. Try and pick the right one would be very difficult. Probably taking cocaine.
Did Berezovsky pay you?
Berezovsky paid me and then didn't pay.
He
paid me and then he died of anger.
Yeah, so you.
But I adored Boris. Yes. Boris was a brilliant.
You introduced him to me. Mm-hmm. I adored him. He he rang me up 2 weeks before he died with the most fantastic plan. I never thought that he would suddenly disappear.
Nobody thought he would kill himself. He didn't. It was clearly murdered by the Russians.
Yeah. And you famously produced that very powerful photograph of what's his name? Looking totally polemiumite.
You know, it's the second most used photograph alongside Che Guevara, the image of Che Guevara in the bearing.
How about Mao?
I didn't know that Mao's photographs have been so well used. According to the book that I wrote, which of course was flat in my view, it said that Litvinenko was the most used image of a lot other than Che Guevara.
Well, there it is. Notorious.
Do you know about Che Guevara? It's a great story about Che Guevara. When Castro got to Havana when the revolution was taking place, they warned the Americans they were coming, and Batista and the girls and went to Miami and all casino operators, and they walked into Havana City and they walked down the main street to the presidential palace, and Castro and Che Guevara and one or two others. They walked into the presidential palace, and Castro sat in the big chair and he said, "Right, I'm the president of Cuba. Is anybody here a communist?" And Che Guevara put his hand up. He thought he said, "Is anybody here a communist?" He said, "I am." That's how he was made the finance minister of Cuba.
What's the word in Spanish for communist and economist? I mean, there's a touch of reality in English. Communist.
Yes.
Everybody who speaks Spanish, yeah. Let's just get it right now, once and for all.
I once went to dinner. And I sat next to a man who said to me, "Hello, who are you?" I said, "I'm Tim Bell." I said, "Who are you?" He said, "I'm Fred, Ferdinand Rodriguez." And I said, "What do you do?" He said, "I killed Che Guevara." That's got to be the greatest opening. I killed him. And they took out a photograph showing a picture of himself standing next to Che Guevara just before he killed him. I still got the picture.
Yes, Michael.
Communista and Ecomanista.
All right, okay, well. All right, we might well just let him off for the moment. There's a slight verisimilitude. Yes. Another question?
I'm just interested because you said that if you were running the Brexit campaign, you would just put a poster out there and swing the vote. And I'm just wondering whether, as I'm speaking to someone who works in advertising, is the value of an advertising agency to a political party the, I guess, creative executions like Labour isn't working, for instance, or is it the, I guess, singular focus on one thing, so banging away at the economy or...
You work in the businesses, all those things. It's not a campaign I would get them to run. I would get them to run a campaign based on the new reference model of opinion, which I would show pictures of ordinary people who are going to vote against it. You won't remember, but in 1959, Lord Winnelton, who was the chairman of the Tory party, ran a campaign called "I'm a Conservative," which was pictures of people who would never have been Conservatives. Melbourne nurses, firemen, coal miners. A big picture said, "I'm a Conservative," and a piece of copy which explained why they were voting for the Conservative Party, the Sun. It's a crap from a creative point of view. The copy was very boring. It was nearly as good as David Abbott's copy, it was so good. And it was a brilliant campaign. They won the election by miles. Harold Wilson. And I think that's based on the concept of reference rather than deference. And I think the art of third-party endorsement has switched from reference, from deference, which is what the campaign is obsessed with. Boris Johnson wants to leave the European Union, Michael Gove wants to leave the Union, David Cameron doesn't want to leave the Union. It's all about celebrities and famous people. It's not about ordinary people. Nobody's running a campaign saying ordinary people want to get out of a bloody thing. And the fact is, it is an almost appalling institution. I'm ideologically opposed to it because it's a union, and unions are just destructive. Like the young doctors are always strung up, and all those stupid women who are making their children study forest trees instead of doing stats. Much as I hate Nicky Morgan, some of this, but I can understand that. If they were honest and just said, "I hate Nicky Morgan," they didn't. And the young doctors, they don't have to work. The greatest art of handling a strike, it was Ronald Reagan when he fired the air traffic controllers. They all went on strike, so they fired the whole bloody lot.
Now the miners, you were brought in to deal with the miners.
Yeah.
What Did you tell Mrs. Thatcher to fire them all?
No, I worked for Ian McGregor, who was the chairman of the
company. Who was an American?
He was a Scotsman. He was a Scotsman, he was a metallurgist. He had run an American mining company called AMAC, and he handled the whole great discipline. And he used to say to me, Dr. Bell, in America, we'd have taken the strikers, and the FBI would have strung them up on the nearest lamppost. There's a lot to be said for that.
You were dealing with Gerald Gorman.
No, I was dealing with Arthur Scott.
Like Arthur Scott.
And the British media.
Yeah.
And the Bleeding Hearts. Oh, these miners, these wonderful people. They wanted to go down the pit, get filthy, dirty, stand in showers. They're the people who don't even want to have seats in football matches. They're the people who want to live their life in filth. They had a union called NACOTS, who honestly, whose job was to walk down the pit with a bloody canary. If a canary died, you couldn't go down the pit because of the gases. This was in 1985, walking down the pit with a canary. They wanted to abolish the pits and build deep mine pits, like they have in Kentucky, where people wear white costumes. They have a McDonald's underground, a Burger King underground, a coffee bar underground. They go down into slip lifts. They wear white. They use machines to get. They don't dig away with a pickaxe. And honestly, the retrograde rubbish that the National Union of Mine Workers talked is so disgusting, it's not true.
Well, there it is. out of champion.
The men who ran the National Union of Mine Workers, Arthur Scargill. Arthur Scargill was a Marxist. He studied under Victor Allen in the Bradford Forum, which if you look back in your history books, you'll find the Bradford Forum run by Victor Allen. Victor Allen was an advisor to Idi Amin, who Harold Wilson got out of Uganda by swapping him for a political prisoner. And Victor Allen taught Marxism. Marxism says that you create order through chaos. What you do is you start a riot, and then the people who effectively you have to call the troops in to stop the riot. And you're the only person who can stop it. So you control the military, and that's how you get control. Marxism is a revolutionary technique. Please, don't we any longer know what words are? This idiot Seamus Mill, who works for Corbyn, he's a Marxist. John McDonald is a Marxist. Jeremy Corbyn is unspeakable. I don't even know what he is. He's unspeakable, but he seems to have a beard. But I learned that, I'm not sure what he does.
Why did you take Rolf Harris on as a client?
I didn't. I done. So the law firm that represented him asked my company nominee to represent his position, and we did.
You did? So you effectively advised it?
No, we advised the law firm.
The law firm to advise it
on what they should tell the president.
And how about Rebecca Brooks? Why did she come to you?
Well, Rebecca Brooks
is all Brooks
clients. Rebecca Brooks came to me because she knows me, because she liked me, because I liked her, because I worked for Ron Murdoch, who was her master. And he was paying the bill, and I was quite happy to work for him as he wanted me to. And he said that he couldn't, unfortunately, I couldn't work for him because there were too many conflicts and he wanted an American firm. So would I work for Rebecca, which I happily did.
All right. Another question? Yes.
Hi. Linked to that and what you were saying earlier about morality, do you think the PR industry has a reputation problem? And if so, does that matter? Did you ever care when you yourself or your agency got
that right? Well, it's an industry that's growing in size every year. More and more people work, it makes more and more money. More clients use it every year, not less. It's more influential than it ever was. So I don't think it has a reputation problem at all. I think there are people who want to give it a reputation, want to go around and say being nasty, but it's always full. The world is full of people who want to be nasty. And they love to knock down tall poppies. And the PR industry is a tall poppy. The people who run it are very good at what they do. You'll see Matthew Freud, he's nearly as good as me. I talk Matthew Freud everything he knows. I'll tell you that if you ask him. Tell the truth. I think that we are accused of doing all sorts of things that we don't do. Just like the advertising industry is accused of making people buy things they don't want. Do you really think that people buy things they don't want because they look at an advert? I mean, do you really have that low view of ordinary people. I don't. I think they're fabulous. I think they make great decisions. I think they know what they... Democracy is about respecting people, not about treating them as idiots. What people don't like advertising is they don't like the fact that people put things up which they don't like. It's more powerful communication than their forward communication.
Yeah, but they make more people buy all the good things more.
If they don't, just put things in a shop window and say you can buy this. They might tell you the price, they might tell you it's available. They might tell you it'll do something that's good for you. Buy that,
but those who don't know about it will benefit from advertising so that they get to know about it. So I mean, I'm just making the point that...
How do you think any idea gets communicated? Any idea in the world?
Well, by words.
Yeah, by communication.
Yes.
That's what I do.
Sometimes
you want to call it PI, you want to call it advertising, you want to call it sales, call it anything you like, forget all the jargon. It's about communication.
Well, a Trappist monk communicates in silence.
But then doesn't communicate.
Yes, it does. I mean, it holds a very...
I've never heard of
Trappist monk. There's a very revered position.
Spencer used to boast about not doing advertising.
Marks and Spencer is going down the tube because they try to sell clothes in white light, is what I tell them. I tell people, you can't sell a shepherd's pie in white light. And in the most awful lighting in Marks and Spencer is that they have light white, and then they come on ceiling lights. And then the worst thing you can do is to get a woman in to try something on with a shadow cast over her face and so forth. And in white light, you don't sell clothes in white light. And Mark Berlin, who I said this to, did a study as to how much it would cost Marks and Spencer to change it to yellow light. It's £150 million. And I said, well, your sales will go down, and of course it has gone down. Sorry. Let's have a last question. Intelligent one. Really provocative. Put him on the edge, because he's too confident. Nobody wants to challenge.
This isn't intelligent, but when you were a young man, when you like started, left school, left university, whatever you did, who taught you to do what you did, or did you just have the chutzpah to do it?
I don't have the faintest idea. I didn't go to university.
Right.
I went. I played the trumpet in a band, and I used to. I went for a tour when I was 18. My mother, who was a single parent, because my father died, but had been divorced, and she was married, said to me, "You have to have a job because I'm not paying for you anymore." So she sent me to a job agency called Stella Fisher in Fleet Street, which I think is still there. They sent me to three interviews. One was a publishing house. One was a television company called ABC Television, which used to have the weekends in Vogue House in Hammersmith. And one was an insurance company. They were all postboys' jobs. The insurance company said, "You won't last 3 months. You're too bright. You'll walk out. There's no point investing in you." The publishing company said, "Do you read books?" And I said, "No, this is what you don't want to come in." Go there. And I went to the television company, which was called it, and I immediately thought, well, they're obviously going to recognize me. I'm in series, I'll be a world famous star in 5 minutes. Because I walked through the door of Vogue House, and there was a scruffy bloke with a photographic kit and a thin girl trying to get in the door. And I opened the door for them. It was David Bailey and Judy Remington. And then I walked into around the corner to the reception area, and there were Sammy Davis Jr. was sitting there. And they were doing the promo for Sammy Davis, which he was sorry. And I went up to see the man who was in charge of this job, which is called chart boy. It don't exist anymore because they've been replaced by computers. And I was a chart boy. And the man who employed was a man called Dennis Galois, which I thought was Dennis Galmont, but he pronounced it Galois. And he said to me, I walked in the door and he said, "What do you notice about my office?" It was a little glass box, a huge great open plan. I said, "I don't know." He said, "Go on. Has it got a carpet?" He said, "Exactly. I've got a carpet." So I thought, that's making me feel very important. And then he said, "Nobody else has got a carpet." And I said, "All right." He said, "Would you like to have a carpet?" I said, "Well, I don't know whether the floors are or not." She said, "Well, I'll play." I became a chart boy. I worked with three chart boys, Dick Raven, who later on became the media director of Great Advertising, I think, and a man called Mickey Finn, who had been christened Michael Felix O'Flaherty Wills Finn by his parents. He was an Irish boy, he was drunk. It was terrible. I don't know what happened to him, I've never heard of him since. And then we were joined by a man called John Cronk, who had the most terrible body odor. And we used to go around the charts, writing BO and spraying, and he used to go and say, God, somebody really smells it. You! Nobody ever told me. My first experience of studying on it. And that's how I got into it.
And do you still not read books?
Yes, I do read books now.
Yeah.
Very not very many, a few. I've read lots of books actually, but I didn't read books up at night. I thought the publisher was going to be pompous.
What are you reading now?
At this moment, I'm reading a book called The Five Languages of Love.
Five Languages of Love. Which five?
I'm on through it. Do you remember to anyone there? It's a book by a marriage counsellor.
Marriage counsellor?
By a marriage counsellor.
Oh. Have you ever seen a marriage counsellor?
Yes.
Divorced twice?
I have seen a marriage counsellor, yes. I hated it. Ask my money back.
I'm amazed. I mean, can you imagine Tim Bell on the couch? You're probably interrupting the therapist more than the therapist telling you what to do.
A very nice therapist. Yeah. She's very nice.
Well, look, listen, in fact, we're over up to five minutes. And it is an indication of how fascinating and enjoyable conversation with Tim Bell has been. So will you please help me thank Tim Bell.